fruit. You know, this is really one of the key words that we have been reading over and over. And we have started a few weeks ago to talk about the benefits of abiding or remaining in Christ. And today we are going to look at this particular theme as one of the benefits, a privilege, how we can bear more fruit by the grace of the Lord. So let's turn to slide number 2, and we will read the text here that you are familiar with by now. He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit, so they will produce even more fruit. I am the vine, you are the branches. The one who abides in me, while I abide in him, produces much fruit. Because apart from me, you can do nothing. By this, my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide or last for eternity, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. One of the greatest benefits and assurance that we have in abiding in the Lord, as we have discussed in many ways, is that in greater degrees, we will be enabled to bear much, not only fruit, but more fruit and much more fruit. Everybody in this room bears fruits. Everybody in the world actually bears fruit. You bear good fruits or bad fruits. So already there is a choice and two different directions. But the degrees of fruitfulness that regards us is also depending on us as well and as the Father. The Father is ready. The Father is at work, and we will see this morning what he's going to do in your life. But are you ready? Are you ready to be the one being used by abiding and letting his life flow through you? The concept of bearing fruit is often used in scriptures. Go to slide number 3, Matthew 13:23. As for what is sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, and another 60, and another 30. So you see here there's degrees of fruitfulness according to the type of grounds. Here we see different types of ground. You are familiar with the parable of the sower. You have which one? The first one is the hard and rocky ground. Nothing grows there. It's too hard. The second one is a shallow ground. There's no depth. There's a rejoicing. There's a beginning, but no continuing, no abiding or remaining, and then it will perish. But the third one, I think it's where many of us are struggling with, is the one that is choked by the weeds. It's the good ground. It's the same ground as the good ground. It's the same seed. It has the same potential. But something outside comes and messes the whole thing up. And in 8:15 here, you see, let me read verse 14. It's not here, but I will read it. Among the thorns, choked with cares of this world, the desire for riches of this world, and the pleasures of life, and it brings no fruit to perfection, to its maturity, to the fullness of what God could have done with these things. Because something has choked it, has prevented it. And this is up to us to let the Holy Spirit and also make choices so that we give the ground of our hearts the full potential that it has so that God can work in that. In verse 8:15, as for what was sown on good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast. They abide in the word, and an honest and good heart, and bear fruit with patience, which means in spite of what life may bring. So in this text, it's not about the circumstances. It's about the heart. It's about the ground that receives the same seed. It's the seed that produces the fruit. So the heart is the condition that will allow 60, 30, or 100 falls. But it's not the circumstances, because it's the heart. But we have to be aware of the cares, the riches, and the pleasure of this life, things that distract us, things that captivate our hearts. We are so worldly minded. We are so materialistic. This is a fact of life. This is how we are being built. We live in a materialistic world. Everything we look, there's advertisement, there's buying, there's selling, there's business, there's all sorts of worries, paying bills and everything. So of course there will be this thing will be so real for us. And if we yield to these things, it will prevent us from being free to be used by the Lord and to bring fruit to perfection. That's the terminology that is used, or to maturity. There's a completeness in our hearts. God can produce the max in our hearts, or we can allow the Lord to produce only fewer results if we went in this way. So if we want to understand bearing fruits, I want to look at Psalm chapter 1, verse 1 to 3, which is a very good parallel text to John chapter 15. You are so familiar. As you see all the text this morning, maybe you will say, oh, it's so boring. We know these texts. We are so familiar with these texts. Yes, we are so familiar with these texts. Hallelujah. But this is the text that the Holy Spirit is bringing to us today. Hallelujah. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. Rather, he delights in the teaching of the Lord and reflects on his teaching day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prosper. So we recognize the similarity with John chapter 15, but we find some elements adding to the text that we have been looking at in John chapter 15. For instance, in chapter 1, it gives us something that we haven't seen in John 15 about the decisions that you and I have to make in order to abide in him and to have the word of God abide in us. Here, this man chose to avoid certain things. And that's part of our abiding. There are decisions. If you want to abide in the Word, and the Word abide in you and abide in Jesus, you cannot go on with what it says in verse 1. With the wicked, with the sinners, be comfortable with them, and let their life influence yours and all this. So there's a certain things that we will need to choose not to waste our time with. Certain things that are really to destroy our relationship with the Lord, or affect it negatively. So I am not to walk, I'm not to stand, I'm not to sit, waste my time with these things, because I have something more important to focus upon. In verse 2, we see also another practical and visual application of if my word abide in you. Here it says, he delights in the word of God. He takes pleasure and he values the importance of the word. That's what this word means. It's so important to you. You treasure it so much. It's important that this word will be effective in your heart, read, meditated, be present in your life, and done with quality. Because as I said last week, once you close the book and you go in the morning after your quiet time, if you have spent a good time in the Word of God and the Holy Spirit has been quickening something, when the book is closed and the Word has been put on the table and you go out of the door, the Word continues its effect. It continues its work. It continues to produce. So it is very important that as people who want to remain in the Word, have the Word remain in us, that we act like this, that we take pleasure. And verse 3, we see another parallel of John 15. Instead of being the vine and the branch, it's a tree and its fruits. And we see the same parallel. He bears fruit, he never withers. You know, in John 15 it says, the one who does not abide in me will withers, it will dry out, it will cut off, and it will be thrown away and burn. Here it says, And the opposite way, if you delight in the word, if you do not associate with the people that will make you fall, then you will be fertile. You will bear fruit. You will not dry up. You know, some Christians, they are up, they are down. They are up, they are down. The cycle of life is up and down. Here is not. Is going straight with the Lord. Is not withering. He is maintaining his freshness. He remains green. Actually, D.L. Moody says, all the Lord's trees are evergreen. So there's always green all year round, because the life of the Lord is in there. So in verse 3, we see this parallel. The tree lives in its fullness because it's connected by the water over here. It's planted by the rivers of water. The ground is fertile. The ground is moist. It's rich in nutrients and refreshment. Hallelujah. It brings its fruit and its season. There's something interesting also in this expression. It means there is an element of time. Element of time. God's time and the time of your need. When you need something, when you are planted by the rivers, the Holy Spirit is at work in your life. The Word of God is abundant in your heart. There's a time where you need grace. Grace is provided. There is a time that God wants to do something. He can use you because you are connected to Him. So there's this element of the proper time where the grace of God. You need the right words of wisdom to speak to someone, they will be given to you. You need strength and courage to resist and facing a difficult situation, a bad news or whatever thing, opposition, it will be given to you at the right time, at the proper time. You will need inspiration and ability to forgive somebody that is really not lovable. It will be given to you. Because the life of the seed is coming through you. When you face a situation where you have an opportunity to do an act of goodness, it will be provided. This generosity, this ability to do something good will be there. Grace will appear and He will empower you. And all He does, He prosper. The word prosper here is push forward. It's not going backwards, not falling apart. It continues to grow. It come out mightily at the end. It reach maturity and success. This is what the Lord is telling us this morning, encouraging us. You dwell in the Lord. This is what God's going to do with you. This is how He will be able to bear much fruit. What you do at that time will be anointed. It will be the blessing of the Lord working in you. The push forward grace of God will be activated in you. Amen? That is what we know from that. Another illustration in verse 3 is planted by. The word planted didn't mean that this tree just happened to exist there. It has been planted. Actually, the verb is transplanted. If you look at the dictionary, you will see it's transplanted. A sprig or a shoot or a little tree has been taken by somebody and planted right next to the water and this fertile ground for a reason, because there it will produce, it will grow, it will be healthy. And it's very important. And if you look at the next slide, look at this verse. It's a very interesting analogy in this one. For the land you are about to enter and take over is not like the land of Egypt from which you came, where you planted your seed and made irrigation ditches with your foot as in a vegetable garden or a rice field. I think the King James and others says, watered it with your feet, or this expression. And it talks about the irrigations, and as an analogy, compare Egypt and the Promised Land. You were in Egypt, and Egypt, you had to use human strength to irrigate your foot, your labor, you had to do it. Because Egypt was a barren land, it would not produce any fruit at all. It's a wilderness, a wasteland. So by ditching irrigation channels and then watering with your foot is like either old traditional methods, either you block the water with your foot and you open the channel with your foot, or it is like some sorts of a manual pump that you would pump the water in the field. But that was used in the time, and the word of God tells us in a comparison, the difference between you abiding in the Lord and walking with the Lord and not walking with the Lord is described here. Here it says, it will not be like the land of Egypt where you had to do your own irrigations because the land was so dry and would not produce. It will not. If you click on the next one, you will see what God is telling to you, what your heart and your life will be like when you walk with the Lord. Rather, the land you will soon take over is a land of hills, valleys, with plenty of rain, a land that the Lord, your God, cares for and watches over it through each season of the year. So this is what the difference. The land of Egypt is you working on your own efforts to try to produce a little fruit that you can because it's a wasteland. And there will not be a lot of fruits over there. But the land of Israel, you don't have to irrigate. The Lord watch over. The Lord cares for. The Lord irrigates. He sends plenty of rains and everything. But and as in the parallel with John chapter 15, we see the condition. If you carefully obey or abide in the word of the Lord that I am giving you today, and if you love the Lord, if you go on with me, if you stay connected to me and serve him with all of your heart and soul, the same condition you see. As I said last week, there are many promises of God. They come with conditions. And most of the time, the conditions is the relationship. You are with me, I am with you. Abide in me, I in you. And this is very simple to God. We are in the covenant. We celebrated the Lord's Supper. We partake in him. He made promises to us. And he wants to bless us, but with our participation. So if we are carefully obeying to him, what he will do? He will send the rains in their proper seasons. He will, so we can bring in our harvest, our fruit of grain, of new wine, of olive oil, all sorts of fruits, all sorts of riches, all sorts of blessing. He will give us lush pasture, not a little bit, but the perfect conditions for maturity. And you yourselves will have all you want to eat. Don't worry. Your Heavenly Father knows. Seek the kingdom first and everything will be given to you. But it comes with a warning again, because we need warnings, because we are quick to forget and quick to disobey and quick to drift away. But be careful, don't let your heart be deceived. So the Lord is giving a comparison between the benefit of him in our lives and the fruitfulness that will come out of our lives just by being with him, just that. So it's not our irrigation that will produce the fruits of our life, the abundance of fruit, the kinds of fruit. There will be plenty of fruitfulness of our life. The only condition, if Christian, we could only understand that principle. Just stick to the Lord. Just connect with the Lord. Go deeper with the Lord. Don't let anything distract you from the Lord. Live completely devoted to the Lord. The rest will come out. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. So what kind of fruit will I bear? What kind of fruit will you bear? When we talk about fruit in the Bible, I think you will agree with that. The first expression or notions or scriptures that comes is the fruit of the Spirit. Yes? Yes, and it is true. But when you talk about the fruit of the Spirit, remember that there is the opposite expression. Because the truth is with that, the seed contains the fruit. Whatever is sown will produce the same type of fruit. The fruit will be in the same nature that the seed is planted. Give you some example of that. And Galatians, as opposed to the fruit of the Spirit, you have the visible expressions of selfish desire and lust. It produces a fruit. The works of the flesh. And James 3, it's not here, don't look for it. Seed of selfish ambition and jealousy will produce fruit of disorder and evil of all sorts of kinds. All kinds. And Romans 7, you live in the flesh, our sinful passions that are at work will bear fruit of death. So you have a seed that will produce the same in the same nature of the seed, the fruit that comes. But then, this, in the same way, in Galatians, we know very that through the invisible power of the Holy Spirit at work in our lives, because we have that kind of seed, then it will produce the fruit of the Spirit. And if you notice, I think you have heard it before, I'm not saying something new, but just to make a point, fruit of the Spirit is singular expression. That stressed that in the person of Jesus Christ, all of these aspects of the fruits are included in Him. He is the perfect person. He has all of these characteristics. He is gentle. He is patient. He is love. You understand that. So, if you and I, if the seed produces the fruit, if you and I have Jesus in me, if I abide in Him, and He abides in me, and His Word abides in me, I will be producing all of these fruits. I mean, all of these aspects of that fruit and my character. My character should show traces or evidence that the Lord is working in my life. Otherwise, something's missing, because the seed works with the fruit. Amen? Amen. I think it's clear. The fruit is singular. The expression fruit to describe, let's talk about some type of spiritual fruit that are named in the Bible. There's one word in the New Testament that is used a lot by the Apostle John. In John 15, it comes 8 times. And many others, at 1 John, it comes also many times. And the New Testament also. And it gives us a clue to how important this theme of fruit is. It's the word carpos. It's just like a fruit, just like a normal fruit. If you look at the next slide, okay, Jesus said like this, a good tree bears what? Good fruit. And a bad tree? Oh, you are so intelligent. Yes. Yeah, you passed the test. 100. Praise God. So Jesus used simple analogy all the time. He talks about this is a good tree, this is a good fruit. And so, but what is the application? Jesus always used the nature analogies from nature to bring an application. In that text here, we're talking about the false prophets. Beware of the false prophets. They come in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Then he will say, can you pick up grapes from thistles or thorns? Or can you get figs from thistles or something? No, the seed and the fruit works together. Another expression translated by the same word fruit is, for instance, the fruit of the womb. When Elizabeth met Mary, was pregnant, and she exclaimed, blessed is the fruit of your womb. So that is the same thing. And that brings to another important realization for us. Let me read it, because there's two parts in this. The fruit is the visible evidence that is produced by the power of the seed that was sown. That's the first part. It's the visible evidence that is produced by the power of the seed. There is life in that seed, and that seed has the power to produce a fruit, a life that will come out of it. Part two, it is born with the nature of the character of the seed producing it. So it has the seed has the power to create life, of the same, but it will be the same nature, the same kind. And we go to John, 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, that explain it so perfectly. No one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him. And he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. That is one very specific application, but the principle remains the same for other application also. Here you see the one born of God. It is born of God because there was the seed, the procreation. The word born here is begat or begotten in the older Bible versions, but it is also procreate. It's the power of the Father to procreate new life out of that seed. That seed of the Father has created new life in me. That seed dwell in me. So that seed will produce in me the same nature, the same character than the one that procreated that seed, that life in me. Do you understand that? I know you do, because you are also, you passed the test already. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So we share the same nature as the seed that lives in us here. So that's why whenever your life, any aspect of your life, your actions, your conduct, your words, your character reflects something that is produced by the power of the seeds of the Father in you, you are showing evidence of that fruit. Any aspect, because fruit, sometimes when we think of fruit, I used to think bearing fruit means or equal doing something. But as we will see this morning, bearing fruit is not only doing something in action. Sometimes you do nothing. It's the power of your character, a transformation, something you choose not to do. It's more about your character, your nature, the nature of God in you that is being displayed. When the nature of your Father is displayed in you, you are bearing the fruit that the Father is producing in you. Say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So this is how it works. So that's why you can bear fruit when you speak the word to someone, when you transmit biblical values, if you are a teacher or a parent, when you bring up life principles from the Word of God, when you share godly advice to a friend or to a coworker, because you are sowing seeds that belongs to the nature of the Father when you are doing that. So you are bearing fruit. That's what. Let's look at some type of fruits mentioned in the Bible. You will see first the fruit of righteousness. Click, and then we will continue. You can click all of them. We will look at all of that. The fruit of righteousness, and we can see it here. Having been filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, so that God will be glorified and praised. So there's a fruit called the fruit of righteousness. It's the character of God in each one of us. And you know, when parents, you love your children. See, there are different kinds of love. Eh? You can love erotic love, filial love, affection, parents, children, friends together, brothers and sisters. And there is the agape love, that the love of God. So when parents, we love our children with the agape love, that means that you are bringing them and the training, the discipline, and the instructions of the Lord. You are preparing them for life. So what are you doing? You are sowing seeds of the nature of the Father that is working in you and the life of others. You are bearing fruits. You see, sometimes I know that some people think that you need to have a special functions. You need to be in the ministry, or you need to be a pastor or a missionary in order to bear much fruit. No, everybody, every Christian, regardless of his age in the Lord, regardless of his function in the Lord, is bearing the fruit of the seed that that is in them. Parents, you have a great responsibility of bearing a lot of fruit because you have so much of imparting of that wisdom and of that love and that corrections and that discipline and the training of the ways of the Lord. Teachers and school, many of us, we have to do that. So you know that you are sowing seeds. Don't put yourself down. Don't think that this text is not for you, because everybody, rich or poor, whether your job is, whatever your money in the bank is, we all bear fruits because we have the same seed of the Father. That's why one of the fruit we will see later is the love for one another. The love for one another is a fruit, because in 1 John chapter 5 it says, the one who has been begat by the Father will love the one that has been begat. If God has given you life, the seed of the Father in you will make you love another one that has been receiving the same. So it's like loving a brother or loving a sister and being attached to them. Hebrews 12:11, we see another adjective added to that, a peaceful fruit of righteousness. I'm sorry, it's a bit, the font is not clear. It was clear on my screen, my computer screen, but the type of font is not very clear for those of you who are in the back. Sorry for that. We'll correct it for the next time. Here it says that all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later, with patience and time, the fruit will yield a peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained. Wait, you will see the effect of your godly training. Just do what's right. Live the life. Speak the words. Sow your love, and you will see the effect of your godly training. The next one is the fruit of light. Again, talking about character, conduct, and relationship. It says, the fruit of the light. Before you were darkness, now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of the light, for the fruit that the light produces consists of every form of goodness, righteousness, and truth. Character, conduct, relationships, and honesty, integrity. Just by being honest, you are bearing fruit. Just by refusing to cheat or to rob somebody or to deceive somebody, you are already bearing a fruit of the light, a fruit of a life that is living in honesty and integrity, open just like God, in righteousness. A fruit of light. The next one, and everybody can bear this fruit, a brand new believer can live this kind of fruit, can bear this kind of fruit. So you don't have to be a old-timer Christian, like a super spiritual Christian. A baby Christian, day number two, he is born again, can bear this fruit that we are reading here. Then the fruit of goodness. God is good. So you should be able to bear the fruit of the actions of goodness that people need. Good deeds, work, ministries unto the Lord, that is bearing fruit. Anything you are doing in the name of the Lord. And notice, maybe something I should add. It doesn't mean just doing something good. It means doing something good in the name of the Lord. I should add these aspects. Because we know that there are many honest people. People can be honest without being Christian. People can be honest without being honest for the Lord. People can do an act of generosity not doing it for the Lord. But I'm talking that when the act, the character, your characteristic, the evidence that the Lord is at work in your heart, when it is coming out of the Lord, you are bearing fruit. When you are bearing the fruit of the character of the Lord, you are glorifying God. God is being glorified by your life, the fruit of goodness. Hallelujah. There's another fruit that we don't know a lot about. It's the fruit of sanctification. It's similar to the fruit of the light, we could say. It has, through the power of God operating, a deliverance in you, the grace to resist temptations, to sanctify yourself, that you know that you belong to the Lord and you don't want to soil yourself with the things, the former sins or whatever. And Romans chapter 6, verse 21 to 22, you have the difference. The old fruits, the former lives that you are ashamed of, fruit that leads to death. But now you have been set free from that, and you live for the Lord. You are slave or obedient to the Lord, and you have the fruit that leads to sanctification and to eternal life. Even young people, children, can bear that fruit. Anybody can bear that kind of fruit. When the young person, and under peer pressures in the high school, they are faced with different temptation, and when they are Christians, they hold on to the Lord, they want to respect the Lord, they can bear that fruit. Of course, there are so many other fruits. You have the fruits of sowing the gospel in the life of other people, the fruit of preaching the gospel, the fruit of bringing someone to eternal life. And you have all of these scriptures here, winning souls to the Lord. It's a gathering of fruit for eternal life. Paul says that he wanted to go in Rome, that he could reap fruit through his ministry to them. And Paul, when he was in prison, not sure that if he would be executed, and doesn't know if he's going to be with the Lord or he's going to remain here, the Lord is going to give him more years. His thoughts and his concern was, if I stay, it is for one purpose, that I can be more fruitful. My labor will be more fruitful for the Lord. So these are another fruit that you see in your life. You know, the desire to be used by the Lord, the desire to share the gospel, the importance. You know, many people, they forget this one. How many people, I don't want to bring condemnation because that's not the way to go, but just talking about it makes people uncomfortable. When is it the last time you have shared the gospel of the Lord? When have you been concerned by the fact that many people that you pass every day do not know the Lord Jesus? So there's a fruit inside. The nature of God inside should produce, at least at times, this stirring up that you want to share the gospel. That is the right time. Remember, it brings its fruit and its season. There's a time. There's a time of God for the person, the seeker. Someone needs to hear from the Lord. There are divine appointments. But we need to be ready for these moments that God creates for us. Another one is the fruit of giving. It is not natural to give money to others. Nobody, if you talk to people who are unsaved, that they don't go to church and have never given their tithes, they will laugh in your face. They will insult you for giving you money to the church, you know, things like that. It is not natural to give. But Paul considered Christian giving to be the fruit from a dedicated life. You bear fruit when you give or provide financial assistance to the Lord's work, to the Lord's servant, to what God is into doing to support the work, the church. Everything works with money in this world. It's part of our life. So this is a fruit, the fruit of giving. When Paul speaks here in this text, he says, and I really like that, The Christian in Thessalonica heard about his conditions, and they responded financially to him. He received it, not only one time, but multiple times. But Paul wrote to them that he says, it's not that I seek the gift. It's not after the amount of money. That's not what rejoices his heart. It's to the realization that the fruit of their giving will increase themselves in depth. It will produce a deeper work of God in their life. There's something that happens when your wallet gets converted. The freedom, the joy, the ability to give, it's something, until you have done it and experienced it, you will never know it. The freedom that you have to give. I don't know if you have ever done that, emptying your wallet, your last token sometimes, just to tell God, I trust you so much. I've done it in the past. I've done it. And or to give more or something and to realize. But then you start to reason. And if I give, should I give less? Should I give more? This person, and all this, is that too much? And then suddenly when you are released from this and you just want to give that above that normally you would not have given, that's a fruit from the Lord. And it's not that Paul seeks the gift. It's the fruit of that giving that will transform the life and the heart. Amen? Amen. And then in closing, you have more fruits, the fruit of prayers. You know, this is an unseen fruit. Only God will see that. And the closet and the secret place, He will reward you. We know that, Matthew chapter 6. You pray, you are really sowing seeds of faith. You are praying, sending the blessing of the Lord, the deliverance of the Lord, the salvation of the Lord, the healing of the Lord. You are sowing. God is rejoicing. God sees it in the secret, and He's going to. So there's a fruit. It's a very important and unseen fruit. You know, probably if we would look into the mysteries of nature, God, there are so many plants and so many things to discover. You know, when you watch Discovery Channels and things like that, you always learn, wow, these big discovery. There must be some sorts of trees with hidden fruits somewhere and the list of all the creation of God. And this is one of the precious gifts that God will honor on that. The fruit of praise, when you come to praise the Lord while you are doing your dishes or your work, or when you come to church on Sunday morning and you pray, there's something special that release you and that honors God, that acknowledge Him, that connects with Him by the fruit of your lips that confess His name, that glorifies who He is. That's a fruit, the fruit of our lips that confess His name. And of course, I mentioned earlier the fruit of loving one another. You know, we have so much jealousy and envy and, you know, hypocrisy and, you know, the selfish, the greed that we have. This is a miracle that we can bear a fruit that, whatever the background, to remove prejudice and, you know, any things that is ungodly, to bear the loving nature of God as we are becoming one family. Amen? So that's what I wanted to share with you. And closing, let's read the last text here together. Would you read that for me? That will be our closing words. That's why you can bear fruit when you speak the word, when you transmit biblical values, share godly advice, bring up your children in the instruction of the Lord, when you give generously to support the work of God, when you extend love, do acts of goodness, live rightly, when you pray, praise the Lord, because you're sowing seeds of the nature of the Father at work in you. Amen. Hallelujah. Would you please stand? Praise the Lord. This is